and gentlemen, a warm welcome to Clare College Chapel and to this pre-Evensong recital in the fourth week of our celebration of 50 years of co-education here at Clare. I'm delighted this evening to welcome back two of our starriest musical alumni, Liz Kenny, who read English here in the 80s, and Elin Manahan Thomas, who read Anglo-Saxon, Norse and Celtic here in the 1990s whilst a member of the college choir. They're going to say a little bit more about their programme, but it is a great delight to welcome them both back. Liz has, of course, gone on from Clare to be one of the greatest lutenists of our generation, regularly performing in some of the world's most prestigious concert halls. And I'm sure that many of you have seen Elin Manahan Thomas at the wedding of Prince Harry and Meghan Markle performing Eternal Source of Light Divine. They've both had glittering careers, and I'm so grateful to them both for taking time to come back to perform with us this evening. Please make them very welcome.
Thank you. a very warm welcome indeed to this service of choral evensong, and a particular welcome to anyone visiting chapel or new to chapel this evening. It's a real joy to have you all with us. As we gather for this service, it's a great chance for me to thank our two Clare alumni returning to college tonight, Elin and Elizabeth. Thank you so much for your marvellous recital just before our evensong service. Our guest speaker this evening is also a Clare alumna, and also happens to be our master, Loretta Minghella, and we'll be hearing the Bible passages that Loretta's chosen to speak on as our readings tonight. So you'll find all you need in the orders of service provided, and you'll see there the choir now sings the opening responses, followed by the psalm.
Thank you. Here begins the 84th psalm. To the chief musician upon Gittith, a psalm for the sons of Korah. How amiable are thy tabernacles, O Lord of hosts! My soul longeth, yea, even fainteth, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh crieth out for the living God. Yea, the sparrow hath found a house, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may lay her young. Even thine altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God. Blessed are they that dwell in thy house, they will be still praising thee. Blessed is the man whose strength is in thee, and whose heart are the ways of them, who, passing through the valley of Baca, make it a well, the rain also filleth the pools. They go from strength to strength, every one of them in Zion appeareth before God. O Lord, God of hosts, hear my prayer. Give ear, O God of Jacob. Behold, O God, our shield, and look upon the face of thine anointed. For a day in thy courts is better than a thousand. I had rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of wickedness. For the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord will give grace and glory. No good thing will he withhold from them that walk uprightly. O Lord of hosts, blessed is the man that trusteth in thee. Here ends the first reading.
Thank you. Here begins the 40th verse of the 8th chapter of the Gospel of Luke. And it came to pass that when Jesus was returned, the people gladly received him, for they were all waiting for him. And behold, there came a man named Jairus, and he was a ruler of the synagogue. And he fell down at Jesus' feet and besought him that he would come into his house, for he had one only daughter, about 12 years of age, and she lay dying. But as he went, the people thronged him. And a woman, having an issue of blood 12 years, who had spent all her living upon physicians, neither could be healed of any, came behind him and touched the border of his garment. And immediately her issue of blood stopped. And Jesus said, "Who touched me?" When all denied, Peter and they that were with him said, "Master, the multitude throng thee and press thee, and sayest thou, who touched me?" And Jesus said, "Somebody hath touched me, for I perceive that virtue is gone out of me." And when the woman saw that she was not hid, she came trembling and falling down before him. She declared unto him before all the people for what cause she had touched him, and how she was healed immediately. And he said unto her, "Daughter, be of good comfort. Thy faith hath made thee whole. Go in peace." Here ends the second reading.
Lord, now let us pray.
So we are seated as the choir sings tonight's anthem, Mendelssohn's Hear My Prayer, O God.
Thank you. Let us pray. In our first reading this evening, we heard the psalmist imagine the dwelling place of God as a house and a home. Even the sparrow finds her home and the swallow a nest for her young, a place near your altar, my King and my God. And so as we pray, we will dwell on this theme of home, a place of belonging and reassurance. We first pray for ourselves, giving thanks for the homes that we know or have known, calling to mind those places and people that instill in us a sense of belonging and peace. We pray for the weeks ahead of us, that whatever comes our way, we would be reassured that we are seen and known and loved. Almighty God, our hearts are restless until they find their rest in you. Be with us through our lives, lead us by your Spirit, and help us to know the belonging that you offer to us, until we come at last to our home with you. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We pray for our college, home and community, to our students, and to our staff and fellows. We pray particularly for those in our community who feel burdened by heavy things this week, and for those who are unwell in body, mind, or spirit. May this chapel and college be a place of rest and restoration, a peaceful dwelling place in difficulty. Almighty God, by whom we each are welcomed, we pray for our college community. Refresh hearts that are weary, bring peace to those in distress, and empower us by your Spirit to turn towards each other as you turn towards us, that we may offer comfort, support, and friendship in trouble. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We pray also for those around our world who do not have a home or who have homes that are vulnerable. And we pray particularly this evening for those in Turkey and Syria coping with the aftermath of earthquakes. We remember those who grieve, and we pray for the long rebuilding that will begin. Almighty God, who gives strength and shelter to the weary, accept our prayers for those whose lives have been affected by these earthquakes. Strengthen them in their hour of need. Grant them perseverance and courage to face the future. And be to them a firm foundation on which to build their lives. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And finally, we pray for Loretta as she comes to speak to us this evening, on the woman who reaches out to the Christ who sees and knows her. Almighty God, blessed is the one who trusts in you. Give us ears and hearts that are open, that as we hear your word preached to us this evening, we may glimpse something more of your love and may grow in our confidence in you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. And so we gather up all of our prayers by saying together the words of the grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, evermore. Amen.
If you'd like to look up, just one or two quick notices before our hymn. If you want to flick to the end of the orders of service, you'll see there a reminder, a summary of all that's coming up over the next week in chapel. This Tuesday at 6:15, there's a special choral evensong here in chapel to mark St. Valentine's Day with some appropriately slushy romantic pieces. All lovebirds are very welcome to join us on Tuesday. No evensong on Thursday because the choir are at an away fixture in Bedford performing their concert programme Attired with Stars. And I think there are still a few remaining available tickets if you'd like to join them in Bedford. Next Sunday, we return here for a flute and oboe recital at 5:15 and evensong following at 6 o'clock, where the guest speaker is our very own Decani scholar and current graduate student, Hannah Fitch. At avid followers of the Sunday evening notices section may be lamenting the recent drought of news regarding our mighty Clare College choir football team. But the drought is ended, because I'm delighted to report that this week our team took on Jesus Choir, and the result was Clare Choir 3, Jesus Choir 0. Our senior organ scholar and team captain reports, CCCCCFC took on Jesus Choir yesterday for the second time this season, but for the unfortunate Jesuins, the outcome remained the same. Clare eased to a 3-0 win, helped by some former stars coming out of retirement for the day. Special mention on this occasion to Schoff, who scored his first deliberate goal this year, and Gallant, who kindly passed the ball for the first time after much persuasion. Congratulations to our whole team, especially to Gallant. At the very end of this service, you're all warmly invited to drinks in the antechapel, and supper with wine is then served in the buttery for those who'd like to stay. Payment for supper is made at the buttery till. You'll also find in the antechapel, as you head out, a donation box and a contactless donation point for this chapel's, this term's chapel charity, which is Bede House in Bermondsey. Bede is a community charity with lively and long-standing links to Clare, and works especially to support those with learning disabilities and those who are victims of domestic abuse. And Bede is offering flexible placements to any Clare or Clare Hall students who like to gain some experience of working in the charitable sector. Do please come have a chat with me or contact Bede House directly if you're someone who'd like to explore that a little further. And finally, you all know that Chapel is very prudent with its finances, so let me assure you that this evening's guest speaker will incur absolutely no travel expenses for her visit. It is a real pleasure and a privilege to welcome from the other side of Old Court our master and Clare alumni, Loretta Minghella. You'll know that before returning to Clare as master, Loretta had a varied career, including serving as chief executive of the Financial Services Compensation Scheme, chief executive of Christian Aid, and the first church estates commissioner for the Church of England. Loretta, we're delighted to have you speaking this evening, and we're looking forward to hearing you speak in just a moment's time. Just before that, we're going to sing together for the first time this evening. It's number 425. In your green hymnals, the words there on the sheet. O love, how deep, how broad, how high shall we stand?
Thank you.
minds and think through them, take our lips and speak through them, take our hearts and set them on fire for love of you. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. In my temporary office in Memorial Court, I have an enlightening little book of cartoons called The Trouble with Women by Jay Fleming. It explains that, and I quote, "In the olden days, there were no women, which is why you don't come across them in history lessons at school. There were men, and quite a few of them were geniuses." When it comes to discriminatory airbrushing, it's not just the olden days, though, is it? As most people here will know, for nearly seven centuries, the structures of this university reinforced the impression that women, though occasionally present, were not in general intellectually gifted, with only three colleges in the entire university admitting women before 1972. When it came to scholarly matters here in Clare, until only 50 short years ago, women were not so much to be seen and not heard as not seen and not heard. One of my predecessors as master, Eric Ashby, described how in the Easter term of 1970, upon the fellowship finally deciding to admit women to Clare, a parcel was delivered to the master's lodge from a former student. It contained his rowing club blazer, together with a note which read, "I am appalled and disgusted at the decision of the college to admit women. After such a decision, I have no wish to wear this blazer anymore. I return it herewith." We've come a long way since then, but of course, there is a bit further to go. My appointment as Clare's first female master has, I know, raised one or two eyebrows amongst our alumni who completed their studies when Clare was an all-male college. One of them was candid enough to tell me that whilst he and his old Clare friends didn't think it was necessarily a bad thing to have a female master, it was regarded as something of a curiosity. They would be watching closely then, no pressure. Now, we heard the Reverend Sophie Young talk compellingly to us last week about one of her favourite gospel stories, the one about the Samaritan woman at the well. And today I get to speak about one of the gospel passages most important to me. Travel with me back in time then, if you will, 2,000 years to the world of Luke chapter 8 and to the story of the bleeding woman who touched Jesus' cloak. Here we meet a woman who's been bleeding for 12 whole years, who'd spent all her money on doctors and couldn't find a cure. By the time we meet her, news of Jesus' ministry and miracles is spreading fast, and crowds are turning out to hear him and witness his healing power in action. Even though, according to the customs and religious laws of her own culture, her bleeding means that she should neither be seen nor heard, nor definitely not touched, she is determined to be there, right in the heart of the crowd. Driven by her faith that Jesus can heal her, she has this enormous audacity which impels her to do that forbidden thing, to touch him, just to touch him, even though she is a person who may not be touched, because she believes just his touch has the power to heal her. And it does. She touches the fringe of his cloak and the bleeding stops, we're told, immediately. And then Jesus asked whoever touched him to reveal themselves, and here's where it gets really interesting. The disciples think it's a ridiculous question to ask, given the number of people thronging around him. She doesn't have to say it was her in that great big crowd. It could have been anyone. But she steps forward. It's tough. She's trembling. But she steps forward and she takes her courage in both hands
and in an act of extraordinary vulnerability, given who she is and what she's just done, she speaks her truth in front of the whole crowd. And she names her condition and her shame and her isolation and her faith and her determination and her touching of him and his healing of her. And it's that speaking of the truth which finally sets her free as Jesus tells her, go in peace. She has placed her trust in him, the one who saves. From now on, she can be who she is. No more trembling anymore. There are just two phrases in this passage I want to focus on, both of which are distinctive in the authorised King James Version we heard tonight. The first explains why she decides to step forward when she does. She steps forward when she saw, and I quote, when she saw that she was not hid. What does that even mean? No one else could have known that she was the bleeding woman who had now stopped bleeding. In what sense was she not hid? Jesus didn't say anything to her directly in the way that we heard last week that he revealed to the Samaritan woman that he knew she had five husbands and was now with a sixth man who wasn't her husband. The bleeding woman just knew that Jesus knew it was her and that she was not hidden from him. And she also knew that he healed her anyway, despite her untouchability in the eyes of anyone else who knew her and her condition. She embraced the knowledge that she herself was fully known by Jesus and still loved, and that knowledge gave her the courage to witness to her faith in him and to know her life to be forever transformed. And that's what this story illustrates so well, that in the person of Jesus, God sees us and knows us and loves us for who we are, whether or not those around us love us or regard us as other, the wrong gender, the wrong colour, the wrong sexuality, the wrong class, the wrong anything at all. And that love, if we can embrace it, if we can put our trust in God, can enable us to speak our truth, make us whole, and bring us peace. What would we see of one another here if our hearts and minds were not hidden? Most of the time, we try to present our better selves, our kinder, happier, friendlier, funnier, cleverer, more confident selves, and suppress our low days, our flaws, our struggles, fears, and weaknesses. Not surprising when we're besieged with images of golden people, gifted, popular, rich, successful, happy, healthy, almost invariably beautiful, with adverts designed to encourage us to change, to become more like them. I'm convinced that the overwhelming message most of us have to absorb every day if we interact with the outside world, especially online, is this: the real you is not enough. What would it be like if we had the courage to speak our truths in public, just be completely ourselves, knowing that we were absolutely enough just as we are? I bet that's hard for many of us here to contemplate. There's a second phrase in the story which might help all of us, and that's when Jesus declares that he must have been touched, because he says, I perceive virtue is gone out of me. Now, the word virtue here is interesting. In the New Revised Standard Version, for example, you'll read that Jesus says, someone touched me, for I noticed that power had gone out of me. Power, not virtue, surely quite different. The word power in today's parlance connotes strength and authority, virtue, more a certain moral excellence. If you explore the history of the use of the word virtue, you'll find that it has borne the more familiar and enduring meaning, a moral quality of special importance, since at least the 13th century. But it has also carried until perhaps the 18th century the connotation of an act of superhuman or divine power, a mighty work, a miracle. So let's put together these different nuances. Something powerful, superhuman, morally excellent, and what do we get? I'd say we get the transformational power of unconditional love. Not power on its own, not moral excellence on its own, but the two combined into a great force for good, capable of going out to one who is in need of it, giving them the space and the courage to allow themselves to be fully known for who they really are, and fully loved into wholeness. This is the love that God has for every one of us, a love so all-encompassing and all-enduring that it can bear the reality of who we are on our good days and our bad days and on every day in between. Could you show that kind of virtue, do you think? Could you go out of your way this week to help someone who feels alone, unworthy, or in need of healing, to know themselves, to be known and embraced and unconditionally loved? I first had that overwhelming sense of being both fully known and fully loved in a church in South London in 2002. It became my church for the next two decades until I came back to Cambridge. The setting you're about to hear of Psalm 84, "How lovely is thy dwelling place," was written for the laying of its foundation stone about 25 years ago. Our Father's house, Jesus told us, has many rooms, and in it, to borrow from St. Paul, there is neither Jew nor Greek, nor slave nor free, nor male nor female, for all are one in Christ Jesus. So this anthem is a reminder to me that there is a place for each of us in our Father's house. A dwelling place not for the people we'd like to be, but the people we are, unhidden, loved, and welcomed home. Amen.
Oh,
as we seek to put our trust in that God of love, we're going to stand to sing our final hymn, Angel Voices Ever Sing. Shall we stand?
Remain with you always. Amen.
Amen.